Joining us for today's webinar, Foster Student Ownership, Individualize Your Curriculum Through Choice Boards. I am your host, Jessica Hayes, and we are joined today by our presenter, Carol Hill. And I'm just going to go ahead and turn it over to Carol to get us started.
Well, hello, everyone. It's nice to see you. My name is Carol Hill. Here's what we're going to be looking at, just some introductions. We're going to talk about the objective. We're going to have little checks for each point that we're going to be looking at. We're going to do a little reflection and closing, because I know teachers need to think, okay, what does this mean in my classroom? And then a little Q&A session for any questions you might still have. Okay, so today's objective, we're going to understand how to offer choice using active classroom lessons for content, for processing, and for product. And those are the three main ways that you offer choices to your students based on how you want to mix it up for them, based on their activity preferences, and even based on the ways that they process the best. So offering choice in active classroom. All right, let's talk about choice. One of the first things in choice is, as I said, you can offer it through content. So that is, how will students gather the information? How are they going to go about accessing it? And then through process, how students will work with the content, because you can't just give it to them. We all need time to talk through it, to work with it. What are we going to do to give these students a chance to process, put it on the work table in their brain in order to really take ownership of that content in order to apply it in other instances? And then the actual product itself. Okay, so how are they going to show how they mastered this content? Because you need that evidence for your grades and for parent conferences, right? So a couple of things to keep in mind. Know your student, because you want the choices to be authentic to them. You want to personalize it as much as you can. You don't have to personalize it every single time. Kids need to learn new skills. That's part of what our job is, to build capacity in our students. However, knowing how a student learns, then that's where you can come in, and you can have a couple of these choices this time and a couple of choices next time. And then also, this allows students to take control of their learning. You know, they want to be free, they want to be in charge. So these are some ways that you can allow them to take ownership and really say, okay, so I learned best this way, this is the way I'm going to do it, because they now have choice. And then also, through choice, you're building kids for jobs for the future, where they will build critical thinking skills, learn how to monitor themselves, and also learn how to problem solve instead of always going to the teacher. Again, think building capacity. Here we go. Okay, most important thing, if you're going to use choice, is you need to make a plan. That is really important. Otherwise, you know, they say, if you don't make a plan, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. So it's important to make a plan. So you need to align to your standard, either your state standards, Common Core, whatever it is that your district uses, and then know what the success criteria is. I will know that I've been successful when I can what? What? How do the students know that they've been successful? And then consider creating a rubric, and those are not real difficult. And if you're one of those that goes, oh my gosh, you know, don't even talk to me about a rubric. Well, there are places online where you can get rubrics, and then you can just edit them to make them their own. And once you kind of get the feel for them, they're not as scary, because they used to scare me until I actually learned how to do them. And then decide if you're using digital tools, and if so, which ones, because you want your digital options, your choices, to match the needs of the kids and what is required to show mastery of the content. Set clear expectations. This may not go the way you think it should when you first begin. Setting those expectations for choice the first time your students do it, very important to guide them through that process so they understand, what does it look like when I'm in control of my learning? So it's okay if you stumble a little bit, the kids stumble a little bit, if there's lots of questions, that's okay, because this is a learning curve if you're not used to doing it. And I'll always check in. I had a list where I would check in with my students. If they were in groups, I checked in with the group. They also had to tell me, this is what I'm going to get done today, especially if it was a project-based lesson. They had to tell me what was their plan. They also had to make a plan and then communicate. Okay, so this is where you're going to show me that you guys know what you're doing, that you've made a plan. This is what it could look like. So you can communicate that with them. I would provide exemplars of what that looks like and then encourage that self-correction. Again, you're going to need to guide them in the beginning. You're going to watch your kids fly. It's going to be amazing. So one of the ways that you can do choice is through content. So what I'm showing here are some lesson options that you find in active classroom. So here we've got some readings. You could have them do one of these readings and choose, or you you could say you can do one of these readings and this reading here that you see, it says, or assign this reading. So have them build some depth or complexity with what they're using. And by giving students a choice here, remember to access the content. Active Classroom has the toolbar, and I'm not going to go into that in this webinar, but they do have the toolbar that allows it, the content to be translated. They can look up words. They can highlight. They take control of interacting with their content to the level that they need it. And the big one, if I didn't say it, they can have the Active Classroom system will read to them as well, if that's what they choose. So this is an example where they can just choose one of these three readings. And then here, this is one lesson where I'm showing you can give this little intro to all the students, offer these as a selection, as choice, and then give this to all students. So within that one lesson, you can offer choice. So let's see what that looks like. So here's this one lesson over here. So when I go in, now you can always add any title. You can change a title completely in Active Classroom. So the thing I'm going to do is I'm going to say, okay, so this is whole class. That way, that's my indicator to my students. Everybody's going to do this assignment. And as you can see, I've only got the one assignment here checked, and then I would give that assignment. Here, each student responds. This is the very last part. So these are examples of what you would do. This is the beginning, whole class, then each student responds. So again, I've got that indicated in the title, and then I've got it checked here. Now, something that I really love about Active, well, I like so many things, but this is another wonderful point, is you can give directions, as you can see over here. And the nice thing about giving those directions, when the student opens up that lesson, they have to actually click those directions closed. These directions will show up on that screen, and they actually have to click the X to close it to access the lesson. So keep that in mind when you're giving directions for your student. All right, so here, now let's look at the content. So here are those documents that are in the middle. So we've built a little background here with economic opportunities. Here is the choice. So I've got choices 1 through 6, economic opportunities. And these are primary account, primary sources, how different people viewed economic opportunities in the colonies. So their directions are here. Your choice. Select 3 of the 6 documents to read and analyze. As you read each one, answer the questions, including documents, and it goes on to tell them about what type of thinking I expect. That's how you can take one lesson, like what you see here, give all your students the background information that they need, give them a choice here to gather the content, and then they all do the document-based question at the end. Okay, so this is with content. Something else that I really like, if you are not familiar with Atlas of U.S. History or Atlas of World History, this is a level 1 Atlas of U.S. History right here. You can see this wonderful map. And then this is level 2. They take it and they dive deeper with it. They add some complexity, some rigor to it. What I want you to see here is these short little bursts, and you can just see right here, of text. So this is another great way that you can give choice. You can let them do a level 1 or a level 2. So that would, of course, be up to you. And then you decide how you want them to do it. Because as you know, in history, maps are vital for students to understand that relative location and the spatial of where did this occur, where in the world. Okay, what I'd like to know with the content, how will you have your students gather their information? So think about learning styles. How do your students best take in and understand content? What about emerging bilinguals? Here in Texas, they don't call them English second language or language proficiency. They don't use that. So the term now is emerging bilinguals. What will best support their acquisition of content? So you may need to think about, okay, I need something that's got some great visuals that will help teach the content in addition to small bursts of text. And then what about students with special learning needs? How will you meet the documented needs of those with learning disabilities? And again, Active Classroom offers scaffolds and the student toolbar for all of those. What about choice through process? How are they going to take in and then work with this content so that they can understand the content, see it from different perspectives, and then be able to turn around and apply this content or this skill in a new situation? How are we going to do that? Well, one way you're going to do that is through the discussions. So I don't know how many of you have actually used discussions in Active Classroom. It's this icon on the homepage. And I don't know if you're aware that every time you assign a lesson through Active Classroom, a discussion option is created in discussions. So that is something that you definitely want to know. Here's one that I added just in general, and that's what it's called. This is general. So we've got economic opportunities. That's the topic. And then they're going to select one of the choice documents, 1 through 6, and post an answer to the DB question. And then what they're going to do is keeping in the character. So each one of those had a character. So out of the three that they did to take in the content, they're going to choose one of those and become that person and answer the DB question, the document-based question. And then number two is they're going to keep in character from their post and then respond to one other post. Okay. So each student will have that option to process. And again, they have a choice. So they've gone through three, taking in contents of those documents, and then they get to choose which one they connect with the most, or maybe it's the one that they think is the easiest, and then they get to respond. And another way, so when you look at processing, the simulations that we have, there's interact, there's plays. I really encourage you to use those in your classroom. This is from the teacher guide of interact. So right here is the name. This is the name of the type of lesson. It's an interact. It's called Pilgrims, a simulation of the Pilgrims' first year at Plymouth Colony. Now, keep in mind that the whole thing may not align directly to your standards, but there is enough of it in here to align to just about all standards. So you can pick and choose which parts of the interact you want your students to do and keep it real tight to your standards, or you can allow them some choice with the pieces that do not align, okay? So that's based on the topic. So you've got the difference between separatists and pilgrims, and maybe that's the part that is part of your standards, okay? And why they came to the new world. So maybe 1 and 2 are part of your standards, 3, 4, and 5 are not. So on 3, 4, and 5, you can let them have a choice of which one of those to do along with 1 and 2. So you're aligning to your standards, and you're still giving them some depth and complexity to their knowledge base to round it out and really feel it out. So another point, you know, social emotional learning, this is like the big buzzword. And I know you guys have been doing this for years. I know I was doing it back in 2005 when I became a teacher. That's just not what it was called. And now we're becoming more intentional with this, which is great. And guess what? Active Classroom's ready, because look at the feelings here that are involved. And one thing I want you to understand is through the processing, you can include, actually embed the SEL component into your lessons. So that's another positive here, is you don't have to say, okay, so what am I doing for SEL today? You can just make it a part of your lesson and just embed it right in there. So that is very powerful. What you're looking at right here on the left, when you go to your activities page and you go to activity type, this is the drop-down menu. Now, there are many different lessons, series titles, I should say, that fall under each one of these activity types. So make sure if there's something you're looking for, activity type is a really great way to go about finding and fine-tuning and narrowing down an activity type that you want to meet the needs of some of your students. Because you can see here, there's audio. We've got audio, the video analysis, everything in between. And this image analysis is really great for those students. I learn through pictures, and a lot of our students do too. And the pictures make history come alive. So here's another way to do it through process. So we've got one of these readings to connect to a speaker in their documents DBQ. So here is the history unfolding. Notice that they're all about colonial life. And you can decide based on these differences here in these image analysis, history unfolding. So they can read here for the reading, but then you can give this as choice. Now again, because now we've got reading and image analysis, here's where you get to choose. If family life and religion, a social piece, is attached to your standards, when you assign these, you can just leave the title the way it is. But maybe it's towns and merchants and settlements that get to be their choice. And so at the beginning of the title, when you would sign it, you can just put choice one on this one and choice two on this one. So that way the students know I have a choice of which one. So that's part of letting them take charge and take control of their learning is you can come up with your own system. The one I showed you earlier in the webinar, that was just an example. You could put whole class, each student, or you can put choice one, choice two. You decide. Whatever you do, I would get feedback from your students the first time you do it, and I would let them help you fine tune how you're going to identify those. It's going to make it easier for you and for them. And they'll probably be like, no, that was great. Just be open to feedback from the students so that you can make sure that you're meeting their needs in order to empower them and build that capacity. Okay. So make sure you guys are working as team members. So here's another one. Okay. So I just have to tell you, C3 Inquiry is one of my favorite series because there's so many different ways to use it. You can see I've kind of gone with the theme for the webinar. This is colonists and Native Americans. Why couldn't they get along? In this day and age especially. Now I know as good social studies teachers, I have no doubt that you all are using primary sources and that you are also showing your students different perspectives on certain events that you want to make sure they understand. Not everybody saw it the same way. C3 Inquiry has several options to offer. If you'll notice over here on the left, you've got a history group, you've got a civics group, an economics group, and a geography group. Again, go back to your standards. That's the really important piece here. And I saw somebody actually taught study skills. So notice that this is under the activity of study skills, the C3 inquiry. So what you can do, a couple of different options. You can let your kids, your students, choose which one of these topics that they want to work in. So that's one way you can give choice. And I usually do like a Google Doc sign-up sheet, and they have to sign up on there. And then I'll create groups in Active Classroom, which is another thing I can do and that you can do. And I will just assign the group theirs. But again, if that's like, wow, that's a lot of work, then just put, when you assign this, choice one, history group, choice two, choice three, choice four is geography. The only thing is you will assign history with choice one and then save it. You'll come back and assign the civics group is choice two, and then assign that one, assign economics as choice three, and then geography as choice four. Okay. So make sure you assign each one of these separately. That's why I've put boxes around those. So you understand that you don't just go click them all and say, pick one. It's going to be a lot easier for your kids to understand what the choices are. If you choice one, assign, choice two, assign, choice three, assign, and choice four, assign. That will be four assignments. Now, this is perspective, obviously, on different concepts here, but you know what? Maybe geography is the one that aligns to your standard. The other three do not. You can have everybody do the geography group. Further down on C3 inquiry, this one has, if you look on the right, has 9 primary sources. So you can take the primary sources from geography group out. Okay, let's say that there are 8 and 9. Then to get a different perspective, you can have sources 1 through 7 be choice sources where they have to select 1, 2, or 3 choice primary sources. Again, that's up to you on how many of the 7 you want them to choose, because 2 of them will already be here in the geography group and you don't want to reassign those. Let's just say, now look at all these choices, and I haven't even gone off the screen yet. This is why I like C3 inquiry. You've got a lot of choices. Or you can bring out all 9 of these, have them choose those, and then choose from the sources and have them answer a question that you come up with that's exactly aligned to your standards. Something else I want you to know too, as far as access to this content so they can process. If the primary source is at a high Lexile level, then there is an adapted version in plain speak for the student. Okay. So that's also a nice bonus for that one. So let's consider processing. I showed you a couple of different things that you could do. We spent a lot of time with C3 inquiry because that one has some great skills skills in it that will build your students' capacity to think, to work with primary sources, and to not only analyze, but synthesize. And that's where a disconnect often happens when kids are working. They can analyze something, but taking 2, 3, 4 pieces of information and synthesizing, that's tough for them. So when we're building capacity in our kids, we want to make sure that we're giving them those opportunities to build their own capacity for learning. So a couple of things you want to think about. Think about time. How long is this going to take? Because you're going to have to make a plan and say, okay, I'm going to say that this is going to take this long. Be willing to adjust that. Again, the first time you do something, you'll be like, oh my gosh, I didn't give them enough time. And maybe you had to cut that part of it a little bit short. And instead of 3 choices, you're like, pick one. And that's okay. This is a learning curve. And then think about your priority content. If you have a state test, if your kids take an AP test, what are the most often tested topics? Spend a little more time on those. Offer some of that depth and complexity with some of the choices that they have. Make sure you know those priority standards. And then level of difficulty, okay? Will this content require additional or varied ways of interacting with the content in order for the kids to really understand it? Because some of the content that we teach, we know when we get to that unit or that part of the unit, we know, okay, this is tough and I've got to offer some scaffolds. So think this through and have that ready. Let's talk about the product. The nice thing about the product is you kind of get some control over this in a way. This is the document-based question that was on that first assignment we talked about that had documents 1 through 6. This is that last one. So it says right here in the directions, and this is part of that part of the lesson that you released to the students. It says, upload your essay to this assignment, paste it in the box below, or follow your teacher submission instructions. So that's a choice right there on how they want to submit it. Some of them will probably want to type right in here. Some of them will want to type it somewhere else, and it says they can cut and paste, or they can actually upload it to Active Classroom for you. So that's just within Active Classroom. You can give them a choice. Let's see what else we can do. Notice here on the left, this is in discussion again. So we've got that general discussion that we had on economic opportunities, and here's the one. And notice the title, final project. So we've got the final project, and this is what it says, the directions inside the final project. Choose how you will present your learning on the 13 colonies. You may choose to create any of the following and upload or link it in discussions. So again, one-stop shopping. But here are their options: a newscast, collage with information learned, photo essay. Those can be really fun. A written essay, a booklet, or another choice that is approved by me. You know, because if kids can think of something, you're like, oh my gosh, I hadn't even thought of that. Yes, you can do that for your final project. Also, I encourage you, if you know that these choices are going to be available at the end for a final project, I would encourage you to show those options to your students at the beginning, because as they're going through the lessons, as they're processing, they can start pulling aside pieces that they want to be a part of a newscast or a part of a photo essay. They can go ahead and do all of that while they're working through it. So by the time you get to the final project, they might only need 1 class period to actually put it together. So that's key also. You know, the more the students know, the more they're going to be able to take ownership of their learning. This is actually one of my activity choice boards that I've offered to students, and I've offered it to my teachers as an instructional specialist. These are just different options, something that I wanted you to be aware of. And again, when you plan this out, the first time it's going to take time, but once I've done it, it's done. And when I offer this slide to my teachers, then they just go in, they can update anything they want to, but the frame is there. They can replace anything inside here. Something to notice, this is something called Storyboard That. And again, they can link that to Active Classroom to submit their final. So I've got a little tutorial in English and in Spanish. We have a lot of Spanish-speaking students in our district. So anything that's electronic, I try to add a little video that I find right on YouTube, okay? So you can do that too. And then I also have the requirements. So all the requirements are here for what is required on this type of choice. What do they have to include. So again, this takes a little while to put together, but once it's put together, it's done. So that's the fun part. And then if you have not looked into this part of Active Classroom, I want to encourage you to do this. If you go to the activities page, you will see searches where you go and you look for the activities. You'll see my content and you will see Quiz Builder. So for a product, you could have kids actually take a quiz. And the nice thing about the Quiz Builder is you can make it a check for understanding quiz or a summative, and it gives you an option of one answer questions. So one answer to it, or you can have multiple answers to a question. They offer fill in the blank and short answer or essay question. So all these different styles are in Quiz Builder. So that again is another option for product. Or you could go in and you could create a specific final assignment for the kids that could be one of their choices. And it's user friendly. There are videos available on how to use my content and Quiz Builder. Okay, in Active Classroom, you will find those. If they're not in there right now, they will be. So this again, Active Classroom has offered you opportunities for the kids for either checks for understanding or ways to check in, and you can put check-ins under my content or ways to actually assess them. Think about choice through a mini PBL. A PBL is project-based learning. Now you can have big, huge PBLs that take 3 or 4 weeks that are really deep, or you can have one that just takes a week. It just depends. This is actually one that we did in our school district, and I and two other specialists put this together. So this is just the beginning part, because remember we talked about aligning to your standards, and we've got some world history standards and sixth grade standards, because that's where we teach world cultures and geography is in sixth grade. World history is usually a 10th grade class, but depending on the high school is where it goes. So this is for the teacher. It just tells them, here's what it looks like. We were doing the 5 themes of geography. And for each one of the themes, we told them, this is what you want to include. Here are some lessons. Okay. Then we created a plan. How long is it going to take for students to do this? Now you can see we color coded it, and we also put what they could be doing every single day, including holidays. And we had one almost exactly like this that we made for the students that teachers could share with the students as well. Now here's coming the fun part. Just give me a minute. So here's an example of a rubric that we put together. Again, it's on the 5 themes of geography. It's based on the requirements page, which the kids would get. Okay. So we said, here are the requirements. And if it says like include 3 to 5 examples, that's where we use those numbers here on the rubric. So there's 2, and here is the pièce de résistance. Oh my gosh, I put this page together and I had so much fun with it, because if you can see down here, we've got articles by continent in a folder. So when you click on the red, that's going to take you to a folder that has articles in it, because the kids got to choose the country that they wanted to do. So all these in bold, these were countries. And you know how we chose the countries? We looked at our standards, and then we also looked at, do you see here where it says regional geography themes and regional government and economic? Okay, those are series titles from Active Classroom, because they already have this information culled, put together, ready to go for these countries. Most of these countries are in our teats, not all of them, but to offer variety, we offered all the ones that were in Active Classroom. Now we had a sign up where students were able to sign up. So the teachers went in and released these lessons to those kids, is how they decided to do it. I think most of them. So we had fun with this. When we got feedback from the teachers, they said it went so smoothly because we put all this together for them, and they were like, this was great. So we've looked at product. How are they going to show their learning? So again, you need to consider time. How much time are they going to need? And if you think back to that color-coded 4 weeks, we had days on there for processing along the way. Process for location during this time. Process for place during this time. Process for, I forget now, region. So we had them, we wanted them to process in chunks and not just do everything and then try to do the work. So you can think about breaking down products that are a little bit bigger. You can say, okay, you're going to do this part of your project today. You've got 15 minutes to pull that part together, and then we'll move on tomorrow to this part. So think about when you're giving a choice of a project for the product, that you break it down and you include that every day or so with your lessons. And that's a really great way to offer that choice and get the product that you're looking for. And some choice reminders. You need to know your students. Make a plan that aligns to the standards. Now remember, you can give some depth or complexity, some perspective that really kind of fills out and fleshes out your standards, especially if you're using perspectives from different culture groups. That really gives the students some background to work with when they're hit with everything that's going on in the world today. Building that understanding of how different cultures can see something differently that happened to all of them, but it's a different experience. That's very powerful. And again, think about that SEL, the social emotional learning for your kids. You can embed that. Know what the success criteria is. What is it you want to get your kids to get out of this, which should be directly aligned to your standards. Remember to create a rubric if that's needed. Not everything you do has to have a rubric, especially if you're going to use the quiz builder, then that's not a rubric. Decide on digital tools. You may want to use the quiz builder. You may want to use the discussion if that's going to be a better platform because you want kids to process. I really like that discussion piece. There's so many different things you can do in discussion for the kids to process their content. Set the clear expectations. Remember, it's about ownership, self-monitoring, self-correction. The kids need to be in charge of their learning and check in. They need to check in with you and you need to check in with them. And then the skills that you're building for the kids. And we want to make sure that they have the skills that are necessary to move this country forward and keep it on track. Okay, so think about what this is going to look like so your kids can access all these fantastic lessons that Active Classroom already has ready for you. And all you have to do is go in and click on the assignments that you want, and then you can go right ahead and assign them, and your job is done. And remember, once you've done this and you figured out how you want to do it, then you can make your notes for next time too. So the reflection piece is really important. Okay. Well, we are so glad. Thank you so much for spending this time with us this evening.
Just thank you all for joining us. But we here at Social Studies School Service just really appreciate you letting us be a part of your ongoing professional learning. And thank you, Carol, for sharing your expertise with us. And I just hope everyone has a great evening.